Good evening, everyone. Welcome to A Word from the Lord. Jim's over here with you. Glad you're with us tonight and ready for another study or continuing study of God's Word. We want to always make sure you know how to reach us if you're interested in a Bible study. Wordfromthelord@gmail.com, 276-340-2653. That's where you can reach me. We meet at 250 The Boulevard in Eden. Sundays at 9 a.m. and 10 a.m. And also Thursdays at 7 p.m. is when we meet for Bible study there. And we hope that you will come out and visit with us, and we'd love to see you or hear from you and be of assistance to you in any way we can. Tonight, I want us to just get right into our lesson here. I've got some information that I hope, will be beneficial to you to help you see why we stress so much that we should follow the Bible. And the reason why is because this is all that we need for life and godliness. Now, we say that, and people say, well, that sounds good. How is it going to benefit my life? Well, let me just show you what I mean. Let me just get into our lesson and demonstrate why this is the best book to follow. You know, it used to be in a long time ago or in days past, our society really looked up to fathers. You know, they used to be respected, highly regarded. If you had a TV program that you were watching, usually the father was the was an upstanding fellow. You know, he was a working man. He was highly intelligent, respected. His wife respected him. Children respected him. You know, come to the father. He's got all the advice, good sage advice, and he's wise and so forth. Even here's a TV program, Father Knows Best. Some of you may remember that. I think I've seen a few episodes in reruns, of course, but nonetheless, it shows that, you know, the father was the head of the family, and he was the breadwinner, and you know, always had the answers. I mean, even you have even programs that were single parent programs. You had like the Rifleman. I mean, here's Chuck Connors, you know, the Rifleman, Lucas McCain. He was a single parent. His wife died, but yet he was trying to raise his son. You had Ben Cartwright. You know, these are programs that were in our past, but yet the father, my point is, the father always had the good advice, and he was the wise one. He was highly respected. But nowadays, when you think about our TV programs and you think about society in general, I think the portrayal of the father in society is evident by how is viewed on TV. Now the fathers are the dumb guys. You know, fathers now are the stupid, you know, the klutzes, the ones that, you know, the kids back talk to and, you know, are disrespectful. The wife doesn't respect them and so forth. And sometimes even, you might say, even the parents are disrespected by the children in general. So more and more you see the role of the father being dumbed down. And I submit to you that this is a reflection of how people will view God. If you think about it, this is how people view God and His Word, because they look at themselves and they say, you know, we're the wise ones. I know, for example, I've never watched, I don't believe I've ever seen an episode of The Simpsons. I mean, it just doesn't appeal to me because of what we're talking about. But when you think about it, I know I've seen enough of, what's the kid's name? Bart. You know, that, you know, the kid is the smart one. The kid is the intellectual one. He's the witty one. He's the wise one. And the parents are the dumb one. I believe that's a reflection of our society. And it just shows that the smart people really are the dumb ones. You know, the Bible says this in Proverbs 12, verse 15. Proverbs 12. In verse 15, the wise man says, the way of a fool is right in his own eyes, but he that hearkeneth unto counsel is wise. And so individuals are fools when they think that they know what's best. And I submit to you that when they start thinking that they are smarter and wiser than God, then they're really showing how foolish they really are. And that's what we're talking about. We're talking about how smart people are when it comes to God, the Heavenly Father. I submit to you, friends and brethren, that the Father, the Heavenly Father, knows best. And the reason why is because his wisdom is far greater than any wisdom that man can come up with. And God has given us his wisdom. God has revealed to us his wisdom in so many ways, in so many facets of life, yet all too often people think that they are wiser than God. But listen to what Paul says. Listen to what Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 1. 1 Corinthians 1 and verse 21. For after that the wisdom of God, the world by wisdom, knew not God. It pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe. Now here we're talking about the scheme of salvation, the plan of salvation. And it reveals that God used wisdom that was so far greater than man's that man looked at it and said, that's foolishness. But yet in God's plan, he revealed the scheme of redemption, and this is part of what we're studying on Thursday night. He revealed the scheme of redemption in such a way that man did not see it coming, and man actually participated in God bringing about salvation when, if man had known what God was going to do, they wouldn't have done it. That's exactly what Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 8. Look what Paul says. Paul says, which none of the prince, they killed the Christ, all right? And none of the princes of this world knew, for had they known, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. If they had known God's wisdom and they had known God's plan, they would not have killed Christ. But God in his wisdom kept the death of Christ and the need for Christ to die secret so much that men actually did what God needed them to do in order to save them. And we know that if that was the case, if they hadn't killed Christ, that we would be hopeless. If Satan had have known that Christ was going to that killing Christ would have been part of God's plan, he never would have done it. And so God's wisdom is wiser. I'm kind of getting ahead of myself there. But notice what Paul says in Romans 1 and verse 20. Romans 1 and verse 20. He says, for the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even the eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. Because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools, and changed the glory of the uncorruptible God into an image made like unto corruptible men, and to birds and four-footed beasts and creeping things. Wherefore God also gave them up to uncleanness through the lust of their own hearts, to dishonor their own bodies between themselves, who changed the truth of God into a lie, and worshipped and served the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. Man thinks that he is so much wiser and smarter than God. I submit to you, friends, the Father knows best. And it's evident that when men think that they are smarter and wiser and more intelligent than God, when they've got it all figured out, that they will dismiss God's wisdom and they will go about and do their own things only to their own destruction. How many times have you seen children do that? The parent, the father, the mother will say to their child, don't do this. Maybe not give them an explanation about the consequences, just say, don't do it. And the child, in their great wisdom, will proceed to go ahead and do the very opposite of what the parent says. They will disobey, and then the consequence. And so they get burned, they get hurt, they suffer the consequences, and the parent says, I told you. You know, the wisdom of the parent was not heeded. But yet when it comes to God, that's exactly how men do. They consider their wisdom far greater, but in the end, man's wisdom is always going to be defeated because God's wisdom is so much greater. God's wisdom is so much greater and higher than man's wisdom. In Isaiah 55 and verse 8, Isaiah, God says through Isaiah, my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are my ways your ways, saith the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. For as the rain cometh down, and the snow from heaven, and returneth thither, but watereth the earth, and maketh it bring forth bud, that they may give seed to the sower, and bread to the eater, So shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. It shall not return to me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the thing whereunto I send it. God's wisdom is far greater than man's, and his word, his plan, is going to come to pass. Now, here's the thing. God was wise enough to know that if he showed all of his plan to man, man would mess it up. I got a little ahead of myself a while ago. Look at 1 Corinthians 2. 1 Corinthians 2 and verse 7. Here again is what Paul is saying. Paul is talking about the scheme of redemption and how far greater God's wisdom is than man's wisdom. All through 1 Corinthians chapter 1, 2, and even into chapter 3, he's talking about the wisdom of man versus the wisdom of God. The world's wisdom versus God's wisdom. And here's what he says. He says, we speak the wisdom of God, even the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the world before the world unto our glory. The hidden wisdom of God is the scheme of redemption, the things that were ordained before the world began, how God was going to redeem mankind. That's what Paul says in the letter to the Ephesians. Ephesians 3 and verse 10. He says it was ordained from the foundation of the world, but it was hid. It was a mystery. It was kept hidden. And Paul says, now we're speaking that mystery. We're revealing that mystery. Because aforetime it wasn't known. It wasn't revealed. And he says, here's why. Which none of the princes of this world knew, the wisdom of God, the mystery. They didn't know about how God planned on saving mankind. For if they had known, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. Now, that's exactly what we're talking about. God was so smart and so wise, he knew, you know what, if I tell them this is my plan, they'll mess it up or they won't bring it to pass. He needed Christ, his son, to be crucified for the sins of the world. Now, that seems like a paradox. That seems like a contradiction. In order to save mankind from sin, sinful man had to kill the Christ in order for them to be saved. Think about that. In order for Christ to save mankind from their sins, they had to commit murder in order to be saved. Now, the reason why is because sinful man was going to die in their sins if they did not have the perfect sacrifice. And so the death was required of a perfect man, and that was Christ. But if God had revealed that plan, they wouldn't have done it. So what did man do? Man comes along and says, you know what? I'm going to, and here's why they did it, friends. Here's why they killed the Christ. It's because they dismissed part of God's wisdom, and that led them to committing a murder and killing our Lord and Savior. Now think about this. If they were doing what God said do, they would not have killed the Messiah. But somebody's always going to do contrary to what God says. Somebody's always going to think, well, you know what? I'm smarter than God. I'm wiser than God. I can do things better than God. And therefore, I'm going to do what God says do, even though I may be disobeying him over here. That's how smart man is. Man says, I'm going to obey God to the point that I'm going to disobey him over here, but still think that I'm obedient to him. Now, friends, you can't say that I'm obeying God on one hand and disobeying him on another hand. But this is what we're talking about. Man thought that when they were killing the Christ, that they were doing God a service. Now, that's what Jesus said to his apostles and his disciples. He said, the time's going to come when they think that they're going to do God a service by killing you. But notice this. In John chapter 5, and let's just begin in verse 7. Jesus is going to heal a man who's been lame. And he tells him to go into the pool, and the man says, I can't. So Jesus says, rise, take up thy bed and walk. And immediately the man, this is John 5 and verse 9, and immediately the man was made whole and took up his bed and walked, and on the same day was the Sabbath. The Jews therefore said unto him that was cured, it is the Sabbath day, it is not lawful for thee to carry thy bed. Now, they're thinking, well, we're going to serve God. We're pleasing God. We're going to make sure that this guy knows that he's sinning because he's actually carrying his bed on the Sabbath day. And he answered them and said, he that made me whole, the same said unto me, take up thy bed and walk. Then asked they him, what man is that which said unto thee, take up thy bed and walk? and he wist not who it was, for Jesus had conveyed himself away, a multitude being in that place. And afterward Jesus found him in the temple and said unto him, Behold, thou art made whole, sin no more, lest a worse thing come upon unto thee. And the man departed and told the Jews that it was Jesus which had made him whole. And therefore the Jews persecute Jesus and sought to slay him because he had done these things on the Sabbath day. Now, we know that it was not unlawful for Jesus to heal on the Sabbath day. As a matter of fact, you can look in other places. For example, in Mark chapter 2, Mark chapter 2 and verse 5, Jesus heals a man of palsy. He said, Thy sons be forgiven thee. And the scribes were sitting there, and they reasoned in their heart and said, Who can forgive sins but God? And why is he speaking blasphemies? And Jesus perceived that this was in their heart, that they reasoned within themselves, said, Why reason ye these things in your heart? Whither is it easier to say to the sick of the palsy, Thy sins be forgiven, or to say, Arise and take up thy bed and walk? But that ye may know that the Son of Man hath power on earth to forgive sins, he said to the sick of the palsy, I say unto thee, Arise and take up thy bed and go thy way unto thy house. Now, they knew that the only way someone can heal somebody was by the power of God. And the only way that sins can be forgiven is by the power of God. So for Jesus to heal this man of his palsy, he was doing it by the same power as saying, thy sins be forgiven thee. Which is easier to say. Listen, I cannot heal someone of any kind of sickness today by saying, take up thy bed and walk, or restoring their hands or their limbs or anything like that. I can't do a miracle. Miracles aren't done today. Nobody can do a miracle today. Just like no one can say, thy sins be forgiven thee. And so Jesus demonstrated he had the power to heal, and it wasn't a blasphemy. It wasn't wrong to do it on the Sabbath day. And so Jesus made the argument another place. He said, it's on the Sabbath day. Don't you get your ox out of the ditch if it falls in on the Sabbath day? So you take care of some things on the Sabbath day. Why is it wrong then to heal on the Sabbath day? But here they're mad at Jesus, or they're accusing Jesus of blasphemy because he'd done these things on the Sabbath day. But Jesus, look at verse 17. Back in John 5, verse 17. But Jesus answered them, My Father worketh hitherto, and I work. Therefore the Jews sought the more to kill him, because he not only had broken the Sabbath, but said also that God was his Father, making himself equal with God. Now we got a double whammy against you. You've broken the Sabbath day, and now you're blaspheming. Therefore you deserve to die. And that's why they killed him. That's why they killed him. Now, they denied the miracles. You know, they just looked over the miracles. Well, we're not going to pay attention to the fact that you've healed this man. We're not paying attention to the fact that you've restored this man whole. We're going to overlook all the other miracles that we have seen, and we know that you did. And we are going to kill you because you could not be the Son of God. Even though you've done all these things, you just cannot be the Son of God, so we're going to kill you. So what they did was they denied the miracles, and they trusted on their own wisdom. And that resulted in them killing the Christ. Now, friends, that's exactly what men do today. They trust their own wisdom. They deny things that can only be done by God. And they turn around and say, well, it can't be God because we don't believe in miracles, therefore there's not a God. We're going to just excuse all that. See, man's wisdom always gets in the way. Man's wisdom will always cause problems. Man's wisdom said, let's kill Lazarus. See, we have to do all we can to fight against the miracles, because that is proof that Jesus is the Son of God. Now, in John 12, verse 1, look at this. In John 12, verse 1. Jesus, 6 days before the Passover, came to Bethany, where Lazarus was, which had been dead, whom he had raised from the dead. And there they made him a supper, and Martha served, but Lazarus was one of them that sat at the table with him. Now let's come on down. And Look at verse 9. Much people of the Jews therefore knew that he was there, and they came not for Jesus' sake only, but that they might see Lazarus also, whom he had raised from the dead. But the chief priests consulted that they might put Lazarus also to death, because that by reason of him many of the Jews went away and believed on Jesus. See, they're ignoring the fact, well, okay, he raised this guy from the dead. But we just cannot tolerate that. We just cannot have someone raised from the dead sitting there as evidence that Jesus is some great person, so we need to kill Lazarus too. Isn't it amazing that here's someone raised from the dead? Been dead 3 days, behold, he stinketh. You know, and that's what his sister said. And here are the people wanting to kill Jesus, and then they said, well, we need to kill Lazarus too, because after all, we know he raised him from the dead, so we need to kill him to get rid of the evidence. If someone says, well, he raised Lazarus from the dead, we can say, nope, Lazarus is still dead. You know, that was just a crazy rumor going around. Lazarus is still dead. Here's his body. We want to deny the miracle, overlook the miracle, in order to get our own way. Friends, that's exactly what we have today. See? Now, I think it's funny that they wanted to kill Lazarus and in order to have a body to show, but in order to answer the resurrection, the body that they needed to prove that Jesus was still dead was gone. And so what did they do? They had to pay off the guards. I'm going to paraphrase this. They had to pay the guards off to say, hey, you know, his disciples came and stole the body while we were asleep on duty. Now, man's wisdom is, let's ignore the miracle of the resurrection. Let's ignore the miracle of raising Lazarus from the dead. Let's ignore the miracle of restoring this man whole in order to then turn around and say, ignore the obvious things that God is saying and doing in order to have our own way. Now, friends, that's exactly what we have. That's exactly what we have today. You ever wondered why evolution got started? Evolution came about as a result of man's wisdom coming in and being smarter than God and said, you know what? We just can't have the supernatural stuff. We just can't have there being a God out here, a great deity, a great mind that created this universe. We have to have eternal matter. We have to have eternal matter that has no life whatsoever, and it is going to produce life, and then, you know, spontaneous generation and billions and jillions and quadrillions of years later, now we have man and everything just evolved. But science says, true science says, that life has to come from life. That life cannot come from nothing. And yet the people who deny the supernatural and say we want science, turn around and ignore science in order to have a way to get around God. Does that make sense? See how smart man is? Man is so smart that he can't even keep up with his own theory. The idea that life comes from nothing is contrary to the very science that they promote and exalt as being greater than God. They got so smart that, as we used to say, they got too big for their own britches. They just don't know anything. They're fools. And so I'm saying all this to make this point, friends. Man's wisdom is foolish. Man's wisdom is foolish when it comes to God. The Father knows best. Now, if man will ignore God's wisdom on one thing, if man will ignore God's wisdom when it comes to something like evolution, or when it comes to things like, or I say when it comes to things like the origin of the universe, or if man will ignore God's wisdom on things like the resurrection of Christ and the resurrection of Lazarus and so forth, don't you think that men would ignore God's wisdom on so many other things because they got so smart? Because they get so smart they got it all figured out? I'm going to give you one example tonight. One example, really, of how man's wisdom is destroying man. man is so smart that he's going to devise a way to fix something, and all he's doing is making it worse. Now, that's exactly what men do. They try to fix something that's not broken, and they create the problem, and then, since there's a problem existing, they're going to fix it with their own wisdom. I was telling the folks in class tonight, I said, that's exactly like a government bureaucracy. You know, the government does something and creates a problem, and now they're going to fix it by creating more bureaucracy to fix the problem that they started. If they just left it alone, it wouldn't be a problem. Well, that's what man does in everything. Here's an example. Here's an example of how man and his wisdom destroys society. Man and his wisdom is destroying society. How's that? By demoting marriage. Now, I want to show you how we demote marriage. We condemn marriage. We destroy marriage. And the bottom line is it destroys all of our society. Marriage among families is one of the greatest, if not the greatest, benefits to children. If you have children that are in a family that is married, it promotes economic self-sufficiency. Now, what do we mean by that? It means you provide for yourself. That means that in a family that has two parents, in most cases, families that have two parents raising the child, they can support that child more efficiently than one parent can. And as a result, the child is better off because he or she is cared for more properly. Now watch how man's wisdom comes in and says, we're going to help people that need help, and we're going to do all we can to make it better for them, and all they do is make it worse. Consider this chart. Now, I hope you can see this. This is a chart of marriage and self-sufficiency. This big graph over here, this big bar graph right here, it says 37.1% of single parent female headed families lack self-sufficiency. 37% of families that are single parent, specifically female-headed, lack self-sufficiency. That means they need help getting by. They need help with food and clothing and shelter. They need help providing for themselves and their child. 37%. Now, I want you to remember that number, 37%. As opposed to 6.8, we'll say 7%, of married families who are self-sufficient, who lack self-sufficiency, only 7%. All right, so we're talking about individuals who are greatly in suffering because they're single parent raising children. They cannot make it on their own. Now, what does the government do? What does man's wisdom do? Man's wisdom comes along and says, you know what? We want to help. We want to help because, after all, children are in bad spots. And you know, when you have single parents, the children really need some help. And here's why. Here's some facts about children raised by single parents. Children raised by single parents are more likely to have emotional behavior problems, more likely to be physically abused, smoke, drink, use drugs, be aggressive or engage in violent behavior, be delinquents, engage in criminal activity, be lower performers in school, be more likely to be expelled from school or even drop out of school because they lack the self-sufficiency. They lack the need, they lack the care, they lack the nurturing, you might say, that comes from two parent families. Now, I'm not saying anything against single parent families. This is not to condemn them. I'm just saying, here's some facts. The strikes are against you. The odds are against you if you're a single parent family. But I'm just saying, here's man's wisdom. Man's wisdom says, all right, this is the problem. As a matter of fact, let me give you some specifics on this. Children from single parent families, more than twice as likely to be arrested for juvenile crime. twice as likely to be treated for emotional behavior problems, twice as likely to be suspended or expelled from school, and a third more likely to drop out before completing high school. Now, that hurts them. That will hurt them in society. I think everybody would say, yeah, that's not good. That's not good for society. That's not good for the child. So the child needs help. The child needs help. But I want you to notice where man's wisdom comes in. Here's man's wisdom. Man's wisdom comes in and makes it worse. And you say, well, how in the world did man's wisdom attack marriage? How did man's wisdom hurt the family? How did man's wisdom hurt the home and hurt the single-parent family in particular? In 1964, President Lyndon B. Johnson, in his inaugural address, pointed out that they were going to start helping people in poverty. It's called the War on Poverty. It's when it started in 1964. Now, when the War on Poverty began, here's the level of unwed childbearing in the United States. All right, way down here. I don't know if I get this exact number here. Looks about like, I don't know, 60-something percent, maybe. Or no, not 60%. I'm sorry about that. It's like 6 or 7%. All right? 1964. The government comes in and says, you know what? We're going to help poverty. We're going to fight poverty. We're going to create some bureaucracies, right? At the time, there was one system, I can't remember, it's the AF some letters, that helped individuals who were in need, all right? We're just going to say the welfare state. Man's wisdom comes in and says, you know what? Hey, let's help this out. So what they do? They introduce more bureaucracy. So when the War on Poverty began in 1964, 7% of the children were born to unmarried women. In 2013, 41% of all children born in the United States were born outside of marriage. Now, wait a minute. I thought we helped the situation. We can't have 7% of the children born in poverty. You know, we need to start fixing something. So what are we going to do? Well, we're going to make it worse to the point that now it's 40%. Now, something happened. Man's wisdom comes along and says, we're going to fix it. Here's another chart. Now, today, 40% of all births are to unmarried women. Now, if you want some specifics, break down by race, 29% of whites, 49% of all births to whites are to unmarried women. Hispanics, it jumps up to 53.8%. And among blacks, it's 72.5%. 5%. But if you average them all out, you get to 40%. 40% of all births are to unmarried women. Now, does that number sound familiar? It's almost identical to the percentage of single-parent, female-led families who are not self-sufficient. My point is self-sufficiency and unmarried families, or children born to unmarried families, go up almost identical. Now, why is that? Why is that? How is it getting worse? Why is it getting worse? I tell you why. Because of man's wisdom. Man's wisdom. You see, man comes along and says, we're going to fix this. We're going to fix this. We're going to make things better. Now, here's what the welfare state does. The welfare state promotes single parenthood. You say, well, James, I don't think that's really the case. How do they promote single parenthood? Well, think about it. It's hard for single mothers to support children without the aid of another parent. I mean, that's a given. Anybody that's a single parent knows it is difficult to raise a child and provide for them. You're providing for yourself. You're providing for them. They don't get the attention that a parent can provide because they're always working, all right? So they don't get anything. You know, the child comes home. We know the latchkey kids. They come home. They're by themselves all evening long until the parent comes home. So it's difficult, and so they need help. So what do? They go to the government. And they say, well, you know what? We need some help. And so the welfare state comes along and says, well, we're going to reduce your financial need by helping you. Since you're not married, we're going to give you some financial assistance. Now, someone says, well, the Bible would say, God's wisdom would say, help those needy. That's exactly right. That's exactly right. God's wisdom would say, provide for the needy. I mean, Galatians 6 and verse 10, as we're given an opportunity, let's do good to all men, especially them of the household of faith. So we're supposed to help the needy. Sure, no problem there. But here's the thing. It hurts the family, even though it reduces the financial need on the marriage, because now this single mother is actually getting some help, food stamps or shelter or Medicare, Medicaid, whatever, Medicaid. And, all these things, those are definitely helping out. But man's wisdom is not helping the problem. See, just giving people financial assistance is not really what's helping people. Because what happens is, as the husbands are absent, there's less need for a husband. Because, why? Well, we don't need a husband. You know, Uncle Sam's going to take care of us. Well, that's not what God's plan was. That's not what God's wisdom. Man's wisdom comes out and says, well, you don't have a husband? Uncle Sam will come in. Uncle Sam will take care of all these kids. Well, you know what? Mama says, you know what? I don't need a husband. But if I have another child, guess what? I'll get more money. I'll get more help. And so it doesn't help society at all. Listen to this. Here is how it hurts society. Here's how man's wisdom has really fixed things. This is an article that appeared in the Heritage Foundation. It says, means-tested welfare system. Now, we're talking about means is what you're making, all right? So if you're low income, here's what happens. They penalize low-income parents who do not marry, or who do marry. These welfare programs are designed so that a family's benefits are reduced as earnings rise. Well, that makes sense. That makes sense, you know. If you've got two people contributing to the welfare of the child, it would make sense that the government assistance would go down. All right? But what happens is, if a low-income single mother marries an employed father, her welfare benefits will generally be substantially reduced. So what the mother does, the mother says, you know what? I can get more welfare assistance by remaining unmarried. I'll live with the guy. I'll shack up with baby daddy. I'll live with him. But you know what? I'm not going to marry, because the minute I say we're married, guess what? Now I have to start counting his income. And I can have the benefit of the baby daddy, right? The baby's father contributing, as well as Uncle Sam contributing. Now it's like a two for one, right? Now I get the benefit from Uncle Sam, and I get the benefit from your baby's father. And so we're not going to get married. Now, is that helping the society? No, it's not helping society. Why? Because statistics have already proven that a married family actually is more beneficial to the child. So, now, she may not be living with the husband or the father. The mother of the child may not be living with the father of the child. She may not be getting any kind of assistance from him. But if she marries, which is what God's wisdom would say, then she loses it. So, why get married? Here's an example. A single mother with two children who earns $15,000 per year would generally receive around $5,200 per year of food stamp benefits. However, if she marries a father with the same earnings level, that is, now he brings in $15,000 and she brings in $50,000 a year, together that's $30,000. But if she does that, her food stamps would be cut to zero. A single mother receiving benefits from Section 8 or public housing would receive a subsidy worth on average around $11,000 per year if she was not employed. But if she marries a man earning $20,000 per year, these benefits would be cut nearly in half. Both food stamps and housing program provide very real financial incentives for couples to remain separate and unmarried. All right? So, there are over 80, and did you know there are over 80 welfare programs that provide cash, food, housing, medical care, and social service to poor and low-income individuals? And each of them has those penalties. So if you marry, guess what? You lose the benefits. Now, man, here's my point, friends. Man comes along and says, well, we've got to help. These people need help, and so what are we going to do? We're going to give them assistance. Well, friends, that's not the best way. That's not the best way, because what that does, that puts a strain on everybody else. It hurts society as a whole. Now, man comes in and says, well, you know, here's my intentions. My intentions were good, and I really intended on this woman, you know, needing help. But what you should do is realize, you know what, God had this all worked out to start with. Father knows best. The Father's wisdom was what really could help society. See, if the Father's wisdom was consulted, if we had consulted our Father on how to help single parent families, this is what he would say. Number one, he would say, don't have sex outside of marriage. That's the first thing. See, the first problem is these people had a child out of wedlock. But the Father's wisdom is this. The Father's wisdom is, number one, don't have sex outside of marriage. In Hebrews chapter 13 and verse 4. Marriage is honorable among all, and the bed undefiled. But whoremongers and adulterers God will judge. So don't have premarital sex. Don't have sex outside of marriage. Because what that brings, what that happens is, well, then you start producing babies outside of wedlock. All right? So don't have sex until you get married. That's the Father's wisdom. That is good, sound wisdom for anybody. You know what, friends? If you are not married to a man or a woman, if you're a man or woman, if you're not married, don't have sex. I guarantee you, your girlfriend won't get pregnant. If you don't have sex, she will not get pregnant. Abstinence works 100% of the time when it's used. It works. I guarantee you it works. And so that's the Father's wisdom. The Father's wisdom is individuals who are eligible to be married. I hate to have to say that. Some people cannot be married. Some men and some women cannot be married to each other. But two people who have never been married before, here's what you need to realize. Here's the Father's wisdom on this matter. And that is, be married and stay married. All right? Here's the Father's wisdom. The Pharisees came tempting him, saying, is it lawful for a man to put away his wife for every cause? He answered and said unto them, have you not read that he which made them at the beginning made them male and female, and said, for this cause shall man leave father and mother and shall cleave to his wife, and they twain shall be one flesh? That is God's wisdom on the matter. God intended one man and one woman to be married for life. All right? Wherefore there are no more twain, but one flesh. What therefore God hath joined together, let man put asunder. Now the only exception to that is this. Verse 9. Whosoever shall put away his wife, except it be for fornication, and shall marry another, committeth adultery. And whosoever marries her which is put away, doth commit adultery. Now, if you're listening to the Father's advice, the Father's wisdom, is don't marry someone that you don't plan on being married to for life. And if you do get married, then don't cheat on them, don't fornicate on them, stay married. That's the best wisdom right there. That will solve a whole world of problems right there. But man doesn't follow that. Now, really, if we promoted that wisdom way back in 1964, instead of implementing all these different programs that would help and actually promoted and actually encouraged people to be unmarried and have children out of wedlock, we wouldn't be in the mess we're in right now. See how man's wisdom comes in and messes things up? So there's the Father's wisdom. The Father's wisdom is on marriage. And then the Father's wisdom is raise your children to obey God. In Ephesians 6, sorry about that. Ephesians 6, children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor thy father and mother, which is the first commandment with promise, that it may be well with thee, and thou mayest live long on the earth. And fathers, provoke not your children to wrath, but bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. You know what would solve a lot of these problems with single-parent families, welfare state, is this. Is if children obeyed their parents, and parents actually instilled in them the nurture and admonition of the Lord. Bring them up to do what God says. In other words, bring them up and listen to the Father's wisdom. But again, it gets back to people don't respect the Heavenly Father. And therefore, they don't really respect their earthly father. Now, I find it interesting. Paul said this in Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 9. He used this example. Furthermore, we had fathers in our flesh which corrected us, and we gave them reverence. Well, that doesn't work today, Paul. Because children today don't respect their fathers. They don't give them reverence. They don't give them honor. They don't look at them and say, you know what, this is my father, I'm going to respect him. No. So how much rather be in subjection to the father's spirits and live? Well, people aren't going to be in subjection to the father's spirits because they won't even be subjected to their own parents. They're not taught respect to their parents. They're not taught respect for authority. They're not taught respect for teachers in school. I mean, you can look on YouTube and you see all kinds of kids in school misbehaving. Well, it comes down to the family, see? It comes down to not listening to what the Father said. It comes down to not taking the Father's wisdom, his advice. Then God said this in 1 Timothy 5 and verse 8. 1 Timothy 5 and verse 8. Here's some more wisdom. Here's some more wisdom that man says, you know what, I'm not really going to take that advice. But God's wisdom is, if any man provide not for his own, and especially for those of his own house, he's denied the faith and is worse than the infidel. No one takes responsibility for their own kids. See, when we get away from the wisdom of the Father, we let boys make babies and then not hold them responsible, not hold them accountable to providing for their own family. Let me tell you, If a man is man enough to make a baby, he ought to be man enough to take care of that child. But you know what? Our man's wisdom comes along and says, hey, well, yeah, he's just a young kid, you know. He messed up his life, so we'll let the government take care of it. When you say let the government take care of it, you're saying we're going to let everybody else in society take care of it. And friends, there's a reason why. There's a reason why the government doesn't mind taking care of your kids. Because then they have control of you. And then they can tell you what to say, do, think, feel, believe. They control every facet of your life. All because you didn't take the Father's wisdom. The Father knows best. The Father knows best. He has the most wisdom. And yet no one wants to listen to him. No one wants to hear what God has to say on the matter of raising your children, of being a parent. And everyone knows, you know, you can't correct your children nowadays. You know, parents are scared to death to discipline their children, let them be disciplined, let them be corrected. Well, yeah, when you disobey God or you don't follow God's wisdom, you don't take his advice, you become smarter, you know. You're going to let Dr. Spock, not the Star Trek guy, but Dr. Spock, you're going to let him teach you how to raise your kids. You know, let's don't discipline them at all. Let's don't correct them. Let's don't make them do anything. Let's don't instill in them a sense of responsibility and obligation, because God forbid they grow up and be responsible adults. That's what we're talking about, friends. We're talking about individuals who don't listen to Father. Don't listen to the Heavenly Father. They don't take his advice. They know better. They're smarter, wiser. And the result is you just mess things up. Friends, this is just, and this, we're talking about marriage here. We're talking about raising children. This is just one way that men mess things up when they don't follow God's wisdom. We're talking about one way where they think they're smarter than God. And look at the mess it's in now. Look where we are. Look at the shape we're in as a society just on this one point. Now, here's some final thoughts. If God's wisdom, if it was followed, could take care of a lot of these problems, don't you think that God's wisdom, if you followed, would take care of a whole multitude of other problems that we're facing in our society? The Father knows best. The Father knows best. The question is, are you going to listen to him? Are you going to listen to his wisdom? You know, the wise man said in Proverbs chapter 1, listen to what he says. He gives instruction to his son. He says, "The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and instruction. My son, hear the instruction of thy father, and forsake not the law of thy mother. For they shall be an ornament of grace upon thy head and chains about thy neck. My son, if sinners entice thee, consent thou not. If they say, come with us, let us lie wait for blood. Let us lurk privily for innocent blood of thy cause. Let us swallow them up alive as the grave and whole as they go down to the pit." What does it say? He says, "My son," verse 15, "walk not thou in the way with them. Refrain thy foot from their paths." Oh, if there was some wisdom that was followed today. If it was just God's wisdom. If it was just the Heavenly Father's wisdom. That is so much wiser and smarter and, you know, more genius than anything man could ever think of, we'd be so much better off. Friends, man's wisdom is going to get you in trouble. You think you're smart, you think you're, you know, all that in a bag of chips or whatever they say today. You think you're smart? You're going to feel really foolish on the judgment day when you tell God, "Well, Lord, I thought I had it figured out. I decided I was going to do it my way." He's going to say, "Your wisdom is foolishness. Friends, God's wisdom is far above our wisdom. Why not listen to God's wisdom? Friends, I'm out of time. I want you to know I want to help you and assist you in any way I can. If you'd like to contact me, you can reach me at 276-340-2653, wordfromthelord@gmail.com. So you can email me. Again, we'll meet at 250 The Boulevard there in Eden, Sundays at 9 and 10, and Thursdays at 7 p.m. If we can assist you in any way, I'm going to do that very thing. Make sure that the wisdom you're following is God's wisdom by making sure you're getting a word from the Lord. Have a good night.